Can you understand Tim when he speaks?
Thank you.
We'll be ready to go right away. As the applause dies, I'm going to get it.
Thank you. gestures for you two to keep crowd. The good news is when we get to this piece, it'll be about a half hour later than it is right now. So that means somebody else will be blind.
Oh,
Bobby, can we go? Bravo.
Where I am, here we are again. 221, yes please. 221, but here let's let Debbie take it. da ole.
And then the pandemic started, and then I was like, well, what am I going to do? I need to have a company myself.
I'm not really good at piano. And so I went ahead and started learning this thing. And I started realizing that the music that I really liked was all the music that was written between 1894 and 1954. So it's a 50-year period called the Tin Pan Alley genre. And I could go on and on and on about the history of this music. And like many of you, I grew up listening to this music. It was in my household, you know, in the good old summertime. It was on repeat for a while for me. And so I realized this music is really just who I am, and I just love it so much. So I went down a crazy rabbit hole, found some really cool stuff that isn't well known, really cool stuff that is well known. And I joined a Facebook group that focuses on Tin Pan Alley music, specifically with using the ukulele. And,
I'm going to stop you.
Yes.
Does she need to be a bit closer to the mic? I'm hearing some feedback. Would you like her closer to the mic?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. If you can
speak, can
you
speak? So.
We need, you know, the other thing is when we put this up.
There we go.
Now, in English, you would like to share with the audience even a little bit of the breakdown that you all hear. So, if you want to talk during your.
Oh, yeah,
a little bit.
Okay. Sure. But yeah, so also, if you might, you might not know this, but the ukulele plays a huge role in American popular music, early American popular music. So, is it okay that I'm sharing this with you?
Yeah.
And so, without going too much into crazy history about it, it originated in Hawaii. I know the great-great-great-great-granddaughter of one of the luthiers, his name is Augustinus, and he created what is now known today as the ukulele. It came from actually a Portuguese instrument, but now it has four strings and looks like this. And because of its accessibility, it's super easy to play, it's super easy to learn. It's very light, it travels very well, it's inexpensive to make, and because of all these things, it became a very popular instrument, especially during a time like in the 1920s, when, you know, we have a Great Depression going on, and we've got, you know, people can't afford to have a piano or a space to have a piano. And then we also see the rise of sheet music. Sheet music starts becoming really popular because we start seeing more publishing companies. You know, composers and lyricists, they want to get paid for their hard work. And so we start seeing all these sheet music publishing companies happening. And then, you know, you see all the rise of sheet music printing, and then you have, you know, more popular music being brought into the home more than ever before, which is really, really exciting. And so there are tons, and I mean, I'm sure many of you have stacks of old music, of sheet music, in your house, and you're like, what am I going to do with this? And you're like, it's an antique, I can't put it away. And some of it is really bad, and some of it is really good, and some of it hasn't been recorded, which, you know, is also really exciting to find. Some of it hasn't been recorded for good reasons. And so, yeah, there's just so much great stuff out there. Anyway, I really could go on, and but I'm going to sing four pieces for you. The first one is called "Living in the Sunlight, Loving in the Moonlight." This was written in 1930 by Al Sherman and Harold Lewis. You might know Al Sherman. Mostly, you might know his sons. They're the ones who wrote like half of the songs that Disney has put out in this entire universe. So, like Mary Poppins and Knots and Broomsticks, Chitty Chitty Bang Bang. Tons of songs, Aristocats, I believe they were the Aristocats. Anyway, this is their dad, Al Sherman. Al Sherman was an immigrant from Imperial Russia. And he came over to the United States and when he was very, very young and grew up in New York City. And he actually was a staff pianist at Remick, I think it's Remick Music Publishing, who was a staff pianist there. And that means that he actually sat in one of the storefronts and he played the piano and like played the newest, latest, and greatest hits. And people would like pass by these windows that were open and they'd hear these really cool songs and they'd be like, oh, I'm really excited to play that. So they buy it, they take it home, play it on their own piano. So this is from a movie called the musical called The Great Pond, but it was actually made famous mostly by a very quirky man named Tiny Tim. And if you're a SpongeBob SquarePants fan, you can find this in the pilot episode of SpongeBob SquarePants called Hire for Work or something like that. It's completely absurd. Anyway, here we are. I'm also very nervous, so I can let you know.
Trying hard all day to get you on the phone to say.
word moon. And so like spoon and soon and
pontoon.
And pontoon, exactly. So precisely. So a lot of songs during this time were written about the moon. In fact, I have like an entire set list that if somebody were to say right now, Sarah, please do a concert about the moon or celestial things from the Tin Pan Alley, I would be able to do it. Tons of songs. So here is Good Night, Mr. Moon.
He took Nellie home.
song. It's called The Girl in 14G. It's about a good Oklahoma girl like me to the big city of Boston.
No, you can't
hold it. Ah, this is about a good Oklahoma girl like me moved to the big city of Boston. Fast. Which I did move to Boston. I live here now, but I used to live in Boston.
We will fake it a little bit, and while we're talking, you get up to the risers.
What are we going to talk about?
Oh, or we're going to talk about Harold Arlen.
Go ahead.
When we talked to Paul Langford about putting together a medley specifically for you, we gave you some choices of 10 Van Alley composers, and you chose Harold Arlen. So I'd like you to tell us why.
Well, firstly, I'd like to say how that there is a that was really, it's very touching. Harold Arlen, so when I was a kid, my parents, they're musicians, and I thought to myself as a kid, I don't want to be a musician because that's like my parents are cool, and so I want to be cool. So I realized that I want to be like a dancer, an actor, anything but a musician. And then at a certain point, my dad encouraged me to audition for The Wizard of Oz. And I was scared of that movie completely. I guess you know, flying monkeys, they were terrifying. My dad encouraged me to audition for this musical. There was a community theater in Tulsa, Oklahoma, and it was a good community theater. And I auditioned, and I got to Lullaby League, surprise, surprise. And I also was an Aussie child in the Land of Oz, and I was also a dancing puppy. And through my experience in The Wizard of Oz, I realized that I did actually want to be a musician after all, and my parents were actually cool for pushing me onto the stage. And so because of my first musical experience, like with people that were outside of my family, was The Wizard of Oz, Somewhere Over the Rainbow is very, very special to me. So I knew that I wanted to sing Somewhere Over the Rainbow. And so to go along with that, I knew also that Harold Arlen wrote a lot of other songs that I had explored and discovered while I was during the pandemic, while I was playing at Glenn. Another song that he wrote that I have always wanted to sing and never have sung in public before, which I'm very excited to do now, is Get Happy. I remember watching Summer Stock as a kid. If you've ever seen the movie with Judy Garland in it, I was obsessed with Judy. And so I watched Summer Stock on repeat all the way until I probably was like left home, you know? And there's the scene where she sings Get Happy, and she's in that really sexy black suit with the hat, and she's got the tights on, and she just looks so incredible, and she just sings the heck out of that piece, and I've always, like, that's been like a dream to be in that scene, you know, to like, you know, Photoshop my face into Judy Garland's face. That would be like a dream come true. And then Down With Love, you know, it's a really cute and fun song, and I love the tune. You know, certain tunes just speak to you, even, you know, text or no text, or like there's that tune, Down With Love, and also Paper Moon. Those tunes, just I love them so much, and so I realized that I couldn't have, like, if I could have anything in the world, it would be a Harold Arlen set, which is crazy because with all this 10 Van Alley music, if you were to say, like, what do you focus on most, I actually focus on the earlier stuff most, like, things from, like, the late 1800s to, like, where it's 1930 is old for me. Like, that's too new for me. So, like, I really like some things that are past 1930, or earlier than 1930. And so the things that are 1930 into the 50s, those are a little on the more just modern side. They're great. They're more like the golden age Hollywood musicals that we know. And to me, that is a separate genre in and of itself. And so I don't really think about Harold Arlen when I think about Tim Cameron, even though he is lumped in that genre. So yeah, thank you guys so, so much. It's really like a dream come true. So thank you.
By the way, do you guys need any comps? see me after and leave the car. Okay, let me know if you can take it.
Thank you. Thank you.
Liz, can you get an extra Arlen to Stephen? Somehow I didn't get it to him. I sent it to you and Ben in a PDF.
Do you need
an
airdrop?
Liz, can you get him a copy? Okay, she'll get it to you before you leave. Okay, that's fine. Good. Yeah, just give me her. That's fine. Very good. Good. Thank you. Good?
Yeah.
I thought it was coming.
Thank you. Irving Berlin number 4, you should have a tab in Over the Rainbow because we're going back to bar 190 for an encore. Okay? That gives you a little chance to find it. You'll have about 2 pages to find yourself on page 27. You just want to go to the front. Okay. All right, let's go and finish out.
Thank you.
Paul Langford arranged that too.
It's the same guy.
Thank you.
just like the last one. When you say, freeze, wherever you are, turn, look at me. Then turn, and Chris coming up, it would be good if you could try to anticipate by that a couple of minutes. Okay? So you can turn when it's time to sing. And then when you're done, scoot a little farther. Don't worry, we got plenty of time. It'll be second ending. We do not need the first ending.
Okay.
Okay. Let's take 41. Sure. Sure. 41. And going to the second ending. Could you please write in crescendo, 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 crescendo? Okay, and I'm asking for it. I'm not getting what I'd like. We need to be a real solid forte by the time we get to God at the bottom of the page. Okay, pick up to 69.
the mouth. And a one. Two bars before agitato. It's our second system, second bar. Sweet. And up.
Okay.
I would say the minute they start, I'm going to come on down. I'm going to all think about it. behind, and I'll get back up here, and I flip my page, and we go. Yes, thank you. 6:30 tomorrow night.